Hallelujah. Amen. My theme this morning, and I trust that we all have an expectation that's in our hearts. There's an expectation that
God is going to send His fire. It will turn out differently the way you might think or I think, but that's not important. If ever God has a thought for us, it's a kind and a life-giving thought. That's what it's all about. Jesus said, I've come so that you might have life and have it in abundance. Glory be to God. If you feel sick this morning, just say, thank you, Lord, I take that pill. That's the gospel. Amen. Some of us, we can remember scripture very well. But I want to greet you this morning with the words in Psalm 34. And there in that psalm, it says in verse 8, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who puts his trust in the Lord. Amen. I praise God. I think it's 33 or 34 years ago now. Is this the 34th independence today? Is it 33? Are we not quite clear? 33. Are we in agreement now? 33. Because it's the power of agreement. So 33 years ago, we trusted God that Namibia would become independent because God has preordained places where you stay and what it looks like when it comes to the different nations. So God had a plan for Namibia. Can you believe it? And He has a plan for you and for me. But it's only called Independence Weekend because of South Africa. But we, as believers, need to be totally dependent upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Can I have an amen for that one?
Amen.
You are not spectators this morning. You participators. Amen.
Amen.
I also want to be encouraged. Now, who remembers last week, Mary was preaching, and he gave us a very sweet story. And that sweet story was about his daughter, Yelani. She wasn't feeling so well. And guess what happened? She decided that evening, Daddy, can you sing a song for me? Lelani, I love to tell you stories, bedtime stories. I'm not good at singing and this and that. But you know, here, Mary, being a loving father, a real daddy, he found the grace to actually sing to her because she insisted. She says, Daddy, sing for me. She wanted to be comforted. She was not feeling well. And then when I was preparing for this morning, I wonder what kind of picture you have in your heart about your Heavenly Father. Just think yourself a little bit. What comes immediately to mind? Is it gladness? Is it joy? Is it uncertainty? Is it perhaps that you feel a bit guilty? Or is he perhaps angry with me? I'm not quite sure. I like to put on the first scripture this morning. Zephaniah was a prophet to the nation of Israel. And God saw how depressed his people were. And so he sent this prophet to give a word to the nation. And I want you to get this word in your heart this morning. Because that's the picture we should carry with us in our hearts about our Heavenly Father. Let's read this together. And understand, please understand, this is what God wants to say to us, so that our hearts will no longer be filled with doubt and unbelief. But this is our God. Amen. The Lord your God is with you. Can you say that? The Lord your God is with you. The mighty warrior who saves, he will take great delight in you. In his love, he will not longer rebuke you, amen, but will rejoice over you with singing. Hallelujah. So there was a beautiful picture of a real daddy. Our Heavenly Father, we don't have to persuade him to sing to us. He's already singing to us. If you tune into him, you don't have to feel guilty. You can just receive his goodness. You know, you remember Moses. I'm sometimes wondering, why is it that we know so little about God? We just want to know about a Savior. We just want to know about the Holy Spirit. But everything that our Savior does, our Lord Jesus Christ, everything that the Holy Spirit does, it flows out of the Father's heart. Jesus came to be the Savior because the Father sent him. The Holy Spirit came because the Father sent him. And the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father agreed to send the Holy Spirit. Because when that happened, where was Jesus? He was at the right hand of the Father. And they were in agreement and they sent the Spirit. That was the whole purpose. And that's the Spirit of life. And the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus sets you free from the law of sin and death. Are you ready for that?
Yes.
So, I think it's important that you are in your own heart, rebuke every thought, every feeling, every attitude that wants to separate you from your Heavenly Father. You see, the kind of goodness that we acknowledge to one another is not the kind of goodness when we talk about the goodness of God. People came to Jesus and one of them said, good teacher. Good teacher. Good teacher. And Jesus was not flattered. You know what Jesus responded? He said, why do you call me good? Now, excuse me. Here is Jesus, the image of the living God, the brightness of God's image. And he humbles himself and acknowledges the Father. You know, when we give our lives to the Lord and then some people clap, you know, who are you clapping for? For the person who given their lives to the Lord? I think we should clap because of the goodness of God that another sinner has been saved. I think we got it all upside down. So it's time for us to realize what Jesus said in response. He said, there is only one good. Who is that? That's God the Father. Because God the Father, in his heart, was the plan of salvation. And then they executed it. And he used Jesus, and he used the Holy Spirit. And together, it's a family business. Are you with me? It's a holy family. Glory be to God. And that's why this morning, I want us to know that revival is the result of God's goodness. Revival is the result of God's goodness. If you want to change your life, you have to focus on God's goodness. Then there is hope and peace in your heart. So, it's no longer good teacher. It's now God, you are a good God. Hallelujah. And any hostile, any distorted picture of God in my heart, Holy Spirit, come and wash me clean from that. That's very important. Do you know why we still have these funny thoughts coming? Anybody got an idea? You know why we have so little revival in these days? It's because we do not allow the sword of the Spirit to divide between the soul and the spirit. When you were born again, you were made alive in Jesus Christ. Are you with me? Do you know that you are alive? Because you were dead beforehand. You had no understanding, no knowledge of God. That sounds a bit hard, doesn't it? Because your spirit was dead, and God is spirit, and he communicates with your spirit. And therefore, if your spirit is dead, how much communication do you have with God? None. Zilch. Because you and I, as natural people, we rely on our five senses. So everything that comes to us and to our minds is about this world. And if our soul focuses not on God, it's about who? Me, myself, and my mother's son. So, isn't it exciting to know that the Spirit and the sword of the Spirit is able to divide between the soulish stuff of mine that wants to distract me from the glory of God? I like to just think of a scripture here, because in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul was preaching to the people in Corinth, and obviously he wanted to make a good impression. I would also like to make a good impression, but I think we need to have a bit more truth than good impressions. How about you? All right, let me read it to you. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, are still not ready. Why is that? Because we allow our own opinions, our soul power, to quench the new life in Christ that my spirit has received. God has made us alive in Christ. Amen? Are you sure?
Yes.
Hello? Now, let us listen to what the scripture says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. Because then you know exactly why you were born again and what is your task as being a child of God. Because you will have revival every day if your spirit is alive to God. Because God is not silent. God is a speaking God. And he wants me and he wants you to be in tune with him. Amen. Let's just have a look at this. As for you, you were dead in your transgression and sin. Can you say amen?
Amen.
In which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. Can you say true? All of us also lived among them at one time, and gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Can you see what's happening? We were following our desires and our thoughts. That's why we think so seldom and glorify God. We don't think of God. It's not natural for the natural man. But for those who are born again, what happens? Like the rest, we were by nature deserving wrath. Now, this wrath is not that God is angry with sinners. This wrath is God who is angry with sin. Because sin stops communication with God. Even as a Christian, if you know that you've sinned, you know your communication with God is suffering. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, hallelujah, what does he do? Made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgression. It is by grace you have been saved. Now, wait a minute there. Can you say, I didn't hear one hallelujah here this morning.
Hallelujah.
You know, isn't it amazing how little we are in tune with the Holy Spirit? We just listen. You see, what's happened is that our preaching has become so mind-orientated that our spirits are neglected. We need to allow the Spirit to have the upper hand. That's why we need to pray right now in the name of Jesus. Let's close our eyes and let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, you have come to give me life. And that life, I want to respond to. But my soul is so powerful and distracts me. I want to give you my whole attention this morning. Holy Spirit, take your sword and divide in me soul and spirit. I need that division to live a life-pleasing life for you. Thank you that there is no other way. Thank you that your purpose is that I now live the life of Christ and do his works that he has purposed for me. Amen.
Amen.
Let's have a look at the next verse. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. Now, I know very well where you're seated right now at All Nations Christian Church. But if you are born again, then as a spirit person, you are seated where? What does it say there? You are seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. Who is aware of that this morning? Okay, there are some. That's good to know. Because if we are not aware of it, we cannot do anything that will please God. Because the head office is there. And the Lord will give us the instructions from there. Glory be to God. Amen? So I'm so glad that there is no confusion. But the truth is that if we are not seated with Christ in heavenly places, we most probably will be defeated. Because our soul always drags us down. And Paul says that we have died to this world, and the world has died to us. And the love of the Father is not in us if we love this world. Just check yourself. If you say you love God, then you no longer can love the things of this world. Because the things of the world are passing away. But those who do the will of the Father will be forever. You see, God didn't just give us life. Jesus gave us what? Eternal life. And the love of Jesus and the love of our Father is an eternal love. So that before the foundations of this earth, can you believe it? Before the foundations of this earth, God already had you in mind. And that settles it. Praise be to God. Good. Now, what happens when we are soulish and we allow our soul to rule our lives? You see, when we were made alive, we became sons and daughters of God. Amen. But when we then slip there, we slip out of that sonship mindset and we slip into an orphan mindset. Does anybody know what an orphan is? Orphan doesn't know his father or mother. And because of that, an orphan's behavior is different to a healthy child's behavior who knows his father and mother. And it was interesting to me to find out that Bill Johnson actually, fostered two young boys who lost their parents. And so they came to the house and they were really, you know, orphans in their mentality. And so when they sat down for dinner, when the food was passed around, everything that could fit on their plate, they got everything on their plate. Anything they could reach, they put on their plate, and then they put their hands around it, or arms rather, to make sure that nobody takes it away from them. Might be you've seen that sort of thing as well. But you know, after a couple of weeks, something changed. It doesn't happen here. It happens here. When those two boys knew that they were loved by Bill and his wife, they no longer had to grab. They no longer had to be self-protective. They no longer had to be self-promoting. They could act as sons and daughters. Sometimes we are so tempted to think that our Heavenly Father is not giving us what we deserve, so we grab it. But if you know your daddy, that he loves you so much, that you no longer have to act like an orphan. You are free. You see, you want all the good things for yourself, but nothing flows out. It's interesting that if you want to know how these orphans live, you have an idea now. But now you can check yourself. What is happening in Africa and across the world? In the past, they always blamed Africa. Now we see that these orphans are ruling the world. They just think of themselves. We think sometimes the politicians are really looking after the people, isn't it? Hallelujah. But there are some politicians that are just orphans, and we expect them to be sons and daughters of God. But they're still orphans. Their position in heaven hasn't changed. But we have now the golden opportunity as sons and daughters to express something of the Father's love to orphans. And that's exactly what God Touching the Nation is all about. God wants you and I to touch this nation. And this is amazing to me that this month of March, so many international speakers are sent by God. Angus Buckingham is coming, and Kent, Zach are coming, and there are many others who have come and gone. But you know, the exciting thing is, that's God's love, because he loved the world so much that he sent. He sent. He's still sending. And he wants to send you, because you, a child of light. You're a child of light. And you can make the difference. And the only way in which the Holy Spirit will move is when we know that he wants to use us, and we prepare ourselves to be used by God. We need to dedicate ourselves to God's purpose. We ourselves need to say, Lord, use me. And especially when we prayed on Friday, you know, when we pray and fast, what we're actually doing is we're just showing, Lord, I'm drawing nearer to you. And James gives us a promise. This promise of God is, if you draw near to me, God says, then I will draw near to you. And that's where revival starts. When you know that God's goodness is actually drawing you. I'd just like to read something from you from, this is an interesting book, The Fire of God by Joy Dawson. And she's been through quite a few revivals. And this is what she has to say. What revival, you know, what picture have we got of revival? And this is what she says. Revival is God greatly stirring, shaking, changing his people from apathy, selfishness, and self-promotion to a desperate, praying, humble, honest, and contrite people with a passion for God. Hallelujah. Hey, where's the excitement here? Passion for God. We want to be passionate about God. Amen. And be passionate about his glory. And we also have a deep burden for the lost. That's what we can expect. What it looks like will be different every time. Because God doesn't make carbon copies. Amen. Oh, good. Thank you. Great. So, you and I, we are no longer foreigners. We are no longer strangers. Amen. To the household of God. Are we? I hope not. So, what do we boast about if we are in the family of God? This is a kind of prayer and a kind of reminder for our spirit to stay in that humble position. This is the prayer. May we never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's where revival starts. When we no longer boast in anything else, there is nothing that's really earth-shaking or shattering, but it's what Jesus done on the cross. It's the cross that crosses all other things out and makes God the glorious Heavenly Father, who is worthy of all praise. You see, when we mouth these words, you know, in our time of worship, it's not when we say, I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. No, it's where your heart is. That's what matters. If your heart has drawn near to God, if your heart is near to God, then you know God is with you. And you know what actually should happen when we worship? We should experience the tangible presence of God. the tangible presence of God. Do we really seek that? Do we really believe that there is a tangible presence? Or do we just say, oh, it's a spiritual stuff. It's sort of, you know, it's floating around, you know, and you get goosebumps. No. It's the tangible presence that changes you from one degree of glory into another degree of glory. Isn't it interesting that God has called us to be holy? And it took me quite some years to understand that if I'm not desiring holiness, I won't get it. We allow the Holy Spirit to make us holy because we desire it. Amen. If we don't desire it, it won't happen. And so, God has made us alive through His goodness. I'm alive unto God. You're alive unto God. You can experience God in a very tangible way. And I'd just like to, in Hebrews just now, to remind ourselves who Jesus is. He is the way, the truth, and the life, right? And He leads us to the Father. You see, Jesus is our mediator, our intercessor. But He leads us always to the Father, not to Himself. Jesus never led anybody to Himself. I'm so tempted to just close your eyes for a moment. If you have a desire to experience Jesus, then put yourself this morning in the position of that woman that was caught in adultery. And she was brought before Jesus. And the religious leaders were already arming themselves with stones, because that's what the law said, that you have to stone a person like that. And here's Jesus. They're testing Him. What will Jesus do? But if you know that Jesus was there to represent the Father, if you understand that, that's why Jesus came, to reveal the Father. Jesus said to us, if you without sin, cast the first stone. Have you been tempted sometimes to cast the first stone? But the only one who was without sin did not cast the stone. God is the only one who can judge us and condemn us. He didn't do it. And so Jesus asked the lady, did nobody condemn you? No, Lord, no one. Neither do I condemn you. But it doesn't stop there. He says, go. Now that you've received my grace and the love of God, my Father, sin no more. You don't have to sin anymore. You are no longer under the law of sin and death. You are now under the law of the life in Christ Jesus. Do you believe that? You are free. Now you are free, not to do your own will, but to do what pleases the Father. Now you are son. That's God's miracle inside of you. And now God, in Hebrews chapter 10, it says here very clearly that Jesus is the new way. It's no longer a way of condemnation and destruction. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place, that's the presence of the Holy Father, by the blood of Jesus, no other way is possible. By a new and living way. That's why Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Opened for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, that's Jesus, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart. And that's why I ask you to pray. With the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. It's a new and living way. When we go into this God touching the nation, we need to be sure that we're not going the old way. We go the new and living way that Jesus has opened for us. Where you become his hands and you become his feet. And where you give freely and the grace of God is multiplied. So, what does God want to do? He wants to revive Namibia. And he wants to use you and me. And he wants to touch each and every one of us. Hallelujah. And so we need to pray for one another. And we need to offer ourselves to God and lift up holy hands. Amen. In prayer and dedicate ourselves and our hands and thoughts to God that he can touch this nation. Through each and every one of us. So let us just stand before him. Yeah, good. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's actually a command from Paul to Timothy to tell the church to lift up holy hands, and especially men. Men need to lift up holy hands and not be angry. But full of the love of the Father, so that we can see God doing something new in our nation. Would you do that? Just lift up holy hands. Lord, here I am. Without you, I can do nothing. But you've sent your Son Jesus to do a work of life in me. And now, Lord, thank you that you cleanse me. Through the blood of Jesus, so that I will use the new and living way. I no longer look at myself. I look to you who has started a good work in me and who will also complete it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And Lord, we trust you for this coming week that we will not miss your visitation. We want to see you, Lord Jesus, lifted high. Oh, we praise you. We bless you and we thank you for just sending your encouraging brothers to us. We praise you for that. Lord, may you be glorified and revive us in Jesus' name. Amen.